Coming up on Need to Know Rochester, a special Voice of the Voter debate. Today we have two candidates running for the New York State Senate in the 56th District. They are Republican incumbent Joe Robach and his challenger, Democrat Robin Wilt. They will be answering pre-recorded questions from citizens in that district, as well as some of the area's leading political journalists.
Rochester's news magazine since 1997. This is Need to Know Rochester.
Welcome to this Voice of the Voter debate between the candidates for the New York State Senate in the 56th District, which includes the Monroe County towns of Brighton, Greece, and Parma, as well as a large part of the city of Rochester. I'm Julie Phillip, WXXI News Director. Our Voice of the Voter media partners include the Democrat and Chronicle, WHAM-TV, and WDKX-FM. Each year, with support from the Community Foundation, we connect with area citizens to find out what's on their minds as they get ready to cast their votes. We recorded their questions for the candidates, and we have selected several of those questions to present to the candidates today. In addition, reporter Sean Carroll from WHAM-TV and Jill Terreri from the Democrat and Chronicle have each submitted a question from their newsrooms. Before we get to those questions, let me introduce the candidates. First is incumbent Republican Joe Robach. Thanks for being here. And next to him is his challenger, Democrat Robin Wilt. Thank you both for agreeing to this debate. Each of you will have 1 minute to answer the questions, and then there may or may not be a follow-up question, in which case you'll have 30 seconds to answer those questions. Prior to this debate, we determined that Joe would answer the first question. This question comes from Brad Files, who is worried about dysfunction in Albany.
How are you going to fix the most dysfunctional state government in our country and get these parties to get along and solve our financial budget problems?
Big question right off the bat. Go ahead, Joe.
Certainly, no question. One of the things that we've tried to and have done, openness and transparency is going to help. Part of the reason why people are aware of what some of the New York City leaders and some of the things that have gone on in Albany have done in the wrong direction are because we're shedding more light on Albany. Openness, transparency, and filings, things I work with Attorney General Cuomo to get passed. I was also very happy that we were able to put a term limit on the leaders of 6 years in the Senate, the House we're in by rule. But much, much more needs to be done. Clearly, what people find wrong direction is spending and taxes. And somehow we have to come up with a strategy to get our New York City colleagues to understand what people are going through here. I formed the Upstate Caucus, and I'm hopeful that whether it's direction, dysfunction, all New York City leaders, by banding together Democrats and Republicans alike geographically, we'll be able to change the course of Albany. And I'm looking forward to working with whoever the next governor is to do that.
Your turn.
Well, obviously, we're coming off one of the most bitterly partisan sessions in history. And my opponent was part of the dysfunction in Albany. He took part in the shutdown by electing one of the corrupt and downstate politicians as his party leader, as the majority leader in the Senate. Obviously, we need to change ethics in Albany. We need to elect new people. We have an incumbency protection program in place. We need to change the rules so the challengers can effectively bring a new voice to Albany and present a different perspective and end the era of partisanship.
My follow-up question to that is, if there were a constitutional convention that would dramatically change the way government is set up and works in New York State, what change would you most support?
I think, besides a constitutional convention, I've been out there standing up to the leaders. I support initiative and referendum, a mechanism to allow people to put whatever they want on big ticket items, no matter what they might be, on spending, on environment, green jobs, it could be anything, to put that on there and get a better pulse and a better voice of what the people want in New York. Much like this show, I think I don't know if I call it dysfunction. I call it there's a disconnect between the New York City leaders and the upstate, okay. if you want to call them leaders or elected officials.
Well, I would consider campaign finance reform one of the top things that we need to address in Albany. I think the people, the voting public, is getting lost in this picture right now. We need to make sure that we have public financing of campaigns so their voice is once again included.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, Robin will be the first to answer this next question, and it comes from Sean Carroll over at WHAN-TV.
Greetings. We all know this is a political climate and season unlike any we've ever seen before. And the winner of this state Senate election will surely work hand-in-hand with New York's next governor, Republican Carl Paladino, Democrat Andrew Cuomo. Their campaigns are gathering supporters and endorsements from across that political spectrum. Is Carl Paladino too controversial? Is Andrew Cuomo too tightly tied to Albany insiders? Everyone has their opinions, but we want yours. Who do you support as New York's next governor? And tell us why.
There's a tough act to follow. Go ahead, Robin.
Absolutely. I thank Sean for the question. Obviously, Andrew Cuomo is at the top of the Democratic ticket, and I support many of his platforms and initiatives. I think he, if he is fortunate enough to gain election, he will set a new direction for Albany that does not involve some of the bitterly partisan dysfunction that we've seen in the past.
Okay, and your turn.
Yeah, I clearly, as someone who's already served and am in office and had the honor and privilege of representing this community, I have to work with everyone in office. I run on my own merits. I have a very good reputation earned from standing up, but at the same time working with people. Mayor Duffy, openly endorsed by Governor Bill Johnson, obviously a Democrat as well. So I guess what I'm hoping for is that both candidates, because what I hear from my public is people want us to fairly reduce spending and control taxes and try and create jobs in upstate New York. I'm going to work with whoever that governor is in hope, because they're both saying exactly what I've been saying for several years now, that we have to control spending in an intelligent way, not take it out of upstate New York for the benefit of New York City, but fairly to do that. So I have to be prepared to work with whoever that is, and I am. What my job will be is to hold their feet to the fire after they get elected to make sure they're living up to their campaign promises.
Both of these candidates calling for significant cuts to spending in New York State. How much should be cut and where?
I think that there's a lot of efficiency to be gained in consolidation in among our bureaucracy. Our bureaucracy in New York State has not been reorganized since 1927, and this is something that we have to take a look at. We have to remove the duplication of effort and make sure that our everybody from the state government on down to the local governments are consolidating and making sure that there's no duplication of effort.
It really has to be much bigger than that. We had a plan 2 years ago before my Democratic colleagues and New York City leaders raised the budget seven times the rate of inflation the first year, four times the rate of inflation the second year, the biggest tax increases in the history of the state. I thought they should take a 2% cut across the board fairly to ensure, again, what's happened in the past, you know, Governor Spitzer's first attempt was to take $21 million out of the Rochester City School District when he got in there, the poorest kids in the state. We have to make sure that doesn't happen. So there has to be substantial plans.
Okay, thank you. Our next question, Joe will answer first. Lynn Wilson owns a flower shop and has a question related to small businesses and taxes.
Well, I'd like to find out. I own a small business here in Brighton, and I'd really like to find out what type of tax incentives we're going to be getting, if any.
Go ahead, Joe.
Yeah, I've had a jobs plan that was endorsed by the Rochester Business Alliance, National Federation of Independent Business People, which would not only cut the franchise tax for small businesses people, like the woman from the flower shop that asked the question, but also even going further and giving a $2,500 tax credit for new jobs created in our state, which I find interesting that Attorney General Cuomo, running for governor, is also now adopted a very similar plan, as well as I've heard several people running for Congress in both parties now embrace that plan that we've tried to get passed in the Senate with our New York City colleagues for 2 years. But it's been something that's substantial and been supported by a lot of Rochester people and business people, and I think that would go a long way to help address her concern.
Okay, Robin.
I think that we need to double the small business revolving loan program. I think that we, again, need to provide incentives for businesses that, tax incentives for businesses that create jobs within the community. And I also think that we need to increase funding for women and minority-owned businesses.
Okay. My question relates more to property taxes. What measures would you take to significantly reduce the property tax burden on New Yorkers, particularly in this region where we know they're so high?
I've already done two things. I'm very proud to lead the fight for the property tax cap, and I was amazed at the thousands of people that signed my online petition, which we delivered to the governor and the leaders in Albany, very active area here, and also another bill to end unfunded mandates to localities and school districts. So even if it's a good idea, we're not passing on the cost to local government unless it's something we really want to fund. If we're able to do those two things, we can really stem the tide. Some people think we need to even go further, but I think that would go a long way and be a great start.
I've been a supporter of the circuit breaker tax initiative that would cap property taxes so that you could guarantee that it wouldn't go above a certain percentage of your income. I think that that's a measure that we need to implement immediately to provide people the tax relief that they need, and so that our seniors aren't forced out of their homes. And I'm sorry, the other part of the question was?
No, I think that the question was, what measures would you take for property tax? Okay. Our next question is from the Democrat and Chronicle newsroom, where Jill Terreri has a question about public pensions, I believe.
Pension costs in New York are projected to increase 37% in 2012. Do you support the creation of a new pension tier or changing benefits in any way for newly hired public employees?
Okay, and the answer comes from Robin first.
Pensions are obviously growing at an unsustainable rate. We do need to do something to rein in the cost of pensions in our state. I'm not convinced that another tier is the way to go. I think that one of the things we need to look at is that 40% of our pension costs are encompassed in health care costs. I think if we get control of our health care costs, we will then gain control of our pension costs.
Okay, and your turn.
Clearly that pendulum has to swing. I've already voted and supported a Tier 5 pension, which added to longer work time and greater contribution. And even I myself am willing to contribute more if that is what needs to be done in order to keep that integrity in that system. I think the times have changed a little bit, and I think government has to reflect that, but in an intelligent way, not an overreacting way.
Okay. Because you were both so brief on that question, I'm going to give you up to a minute for my follow-up question, and that is, do you think the state workforce should be cut? If so, by how much and in what areas?
As I mentioned earlier, the state workforce, the bureaucracy of New York State has not been reorganized since 1927. Under 44 years of Republican control of the Senate, we saw profligate increases in the amount of taxation and the size of the bureaucracy. And now we're in a position where we do have to tighten our belts. I think if we examine our bureaucracy and find places where we can consolidate, we will be able to make the cuts we need.
Julie, I lead by example. I myself have cut over 10% of my own allotment to run my own office that I've been given because I want to lead by example. I've asked other people to do that. I think we could merge the Thruway Authority with DOT, the Liquor Authority with Economic Development, and nothing could be further than the truth. With the new control of New York City being in control of everything, they have added to political employees in their own office through the roof, both in the governor's office and the Senate. I think that should be eliminated. Everybody needs to do their part. And if we're going to be serious about turning this big ship, New York government, people have to lead by example and start having less government employees. Not ones doing services to the public, nurses, workers, people right in government in Albany. Instead, the current leadership there has gone in exactly the opposite direction at the most challenging time in our history, and I will always fight that.
All right. Thank you, Joe. Our next question is about jobs, and it comes from Oscar Abney.
Why don't we use local contractors for big jobs such as Midtown, and since we always use out of state contractors, but contractors from different cities instead of our own, which will give us our people places to work.
Joe, your first.
Absolutely.
Up.
Great question. I'm very happy that we're finally getting to school modernization, which there'll be a local component, a minority component of the largest degree. For Midtown, there are rules in place. Very happy to have that apply to New York. I like to go even one step further than those job protections. I've always supported work very closely with people in construction, in the building trades, on project labor agreements, which really ensure that it will be inclusive and that the work will stay here and be local companies. I think that's imperative. I've always supported that and will continue to do that. There's actually pretty good rules in place. Sometimes it's an issue of making sure people are following the rules when they do the job. But I have every hope that the Duffy administration will make sure those are applied when they do Midtown Plaza, which was Mr. Dabney, I believe his name was, specific question.
Okay, your turn, Robin.
That is an excellent question, and I do think that we need to create economic opportunity within our community. I support green initiatives. Obviously, Rochester's infrastructure hasn't been upgraded since the 1950s, 1960s, along with many infrastructures across the country. And we have an opportunity in the Green Jobs Initiative to create local homegrown jobs and at the same time reduce our energy costs and streamline the system to create the green technologies that we need for the 20th century.
Okay. For my follow-up again, I'm going to give you a minute because it's sort of a big question. I want to hear your best ideas for creating jobs in New York State.
Certainly. And, you know, I can honestly say even with the challenges, I've been very fortunate to be in a position to be a partner to create a lot of jobs. The medical center, which were instrumental in funding, and the spinoff jobs at the U of R have been great. We voted for the Green Jobs Initiative, and now I'm hoping that RIT, which we've helped fund, the Center for Sustainability and Green Technology, will become the hub that many governors have talked about here in New York State for green, renewable energy and the technology that's emerging very rapidly. Been working with people in the auto industry, and at UAW, hoping that the fuel cell will expand, working in conjunction with Congresswoman Slaughter. So we need to have some acorn grow into the oak, but at the same time, and here's there's a huge difference, we have to be willing to reduce spending and costs to businesses to create jobs globally. Most of the jobs that will be created are small businesses. My plan that I have, real plan, real action, real cuts, challenging, will really affect that, and I hope that will help all businesses as well.
Okay, Robin, you have a minute to talk about job creation in New York State.
In addition to the Green Jobs Initiative, I think that we have an opportunity to partner, to create partnerships with SUNY institutions to develop technologies here. We also have some opportunities in the development of wind energy and other fuel-efficient technologies here. Senator Robach did mention the fuel cell technology being developed locally. In addition to that, I think that we need to support small businesses. We talked about the tax incentives to create jobs locally. But really, the emphasis on green job creation and the development of already burgeoning technological centers here, I think, will create a lot of economic development within our locality.
Okay. Our next question is from Brandy Douglas, and she is worried about urban education.
What would you do more to help our children in the inner city with their education? Because I've starting to realize that our children are falling behind everywhere else, our whole country basically is falling behind with our educational, meeting our educational needs for our children, and what can we do to step it up?
Okay, Robin.
Well, we do have a crisis situation in terms of urban education in Rochester. It is unconscionable that we have a 46% high school graduation rate. And we cannot continue to fail our children. Our future is sitting in the classrooms of today, and through inaction, we've allowed a crisis situation to develop. I support education reform. I think we need something on the order of the Abbott plan, which New Jersey implemented, which has UPK programs starting from age 3. We need to reduce our class sizes. We need to increase recreational programs and build community. A lot of our problems are associated with the fact that Rochester is the 9th impoverished city in the country. We need to do something to build our families, rebuild that family infrastructure so that parents are more involved in their children's education.
And your turn.
Absolutely. I spend a lot of time in schools and in classrooms, and it's sad that if you think, when you look out, you see some of these beautiful children, knowing that if the statistic stays the same, when I'm in a city school, probably not more than half of those kids are going to graduate. I really believe you have to make pre-K, after-school programs the norm, and I love the idea of making schools a community center like they did at 17, where they had a health clinic or other things. Let not-for-profits in. Change some of these archaic rules at no cost so the parents and parent, in some cases, will have more of a buy-in and take a little bit more interest in their education. And then I think you have to duplicate inside the city school district what's working. Last night, I was at the IB program induction at Wilson. That school is going great. Let's duplicate more of what's working. I think we're now seeing charter schools in the city outperforming some urban school or suburban schools, which is absolutely phenomenal. And now they're becoming more of the public education norm. Well, I hope we could have the same time, each of us.
You both had 1 minute for that question.
Okay. All right, I'm sorry.
That's all right. You will have a little time because I'm going to ask one more question related to education. I'd like to hear your thoughts on mayoral control of Rochester City Schools.
I've been very clear on my position of mayoral control. I've examined the legislation. I like some aspects of the legislation. I like the fact that it provides for increased parental involvement with the schools, which I think is critical in order to overcome some of the problems we face. Some of the concerns I have with the legislation involves the fact that this is not truly education reform. This is school governance reform. And I think that we need to address some of the issues that directly impact our graduation rates. I mentioned the fact that we have the 9th most impoverished city in the nation. In addition to that, we have some of the highest teen pregnancy rates in the nation. And unless we get a handle on some of those factors that influence the low graduation rate, we're not going to be successful, regardless who controls the school.
Okay, and you will have a minute, too.
I always try to listen to the public I have the honor and privilege of representing. And I've heard loud and clear from them. Many people want to know why city taxpayers, why people in urban areas, people of color, would be treated differently than people in the suburbs on this. So I thought there was a right way and a wrong way to do it, and I've had this dialogue with many people in the community. I think if they want to change something as traditional as this, everything should be on the table to be discussed, but let's have more specifics for the public who have asked for that, and let the people in Rochester vote, just like they do in suburban school districts, what's going to impact their kids and the bill they pay. To me, this is a simple way to get to the right place and also encourage more buy-in of people to do this monumental change of taking away elected board, which some could make the argument would be more responsive to the public, to an appointed board.
Just time now to deliver your closing statements, and we discussed this beforehand, and Joe will be the first to deliver his 1 minute closing statement.
Absolutely. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for those of you that are watching. I think now more than ever, we need people who will stand up, regardless of party leaders, regardless of party, and represent their area. We are at a crossroads in New York. Upstate New York has been treated very poorly over the last 2 years. We're moving in the wrong direction, very New York City-centric based. We have to intelligently and fairly control spending, prioritize effectively using our resources to help young and old alike. And we need people that aren't going to hide behind a party, but are going to work for people to stand up and try and do the right thing, even when it's challenging. I've done that. I think that, and I hope, that I have earned the right to ask for your support to continue to represent you in these challenging times. And again, thank you for watching.
And thank you. And your turn, Robin Wilt.
Thank you for having me today. The questions were wonderful. It shows that people are at a point in time right now where they know that we need change in government. The status quo is not working. We need people who have been engaged on the community level, like myself, who offer a different perspective to Albany. For too long, we have let Albany incumbents, longtime career politicians who are only concerned with their own incumbency and reelection, control things. We need somebody who's going to stand up for the voice of everyday working families and the communities. So I hope, come November 2nd, to have your support, because it's time for a change.
This concludes our Voice of the Voter debate between the candidates for the New York State Senate in the 56th District. Thank you, Joe Robach and Robin Wilt, for being with us today. Also, thank you to the citizens who took part in our debate and our Voice of the Voter media partners. I'm Julie Phillip. Thanks for joining us.